Hello, welcome. This is Zastro, Module 3, Reality Therapy. So we're going to talk a little bit about William Glasser's reality therapy. He was a psychiatrist that kind of founded this whole theory or thought. A little tidbit of information about Glasser is that he worked at the Ventura School for Girls, a delinquent school for girls in California. This is where he grew skeptical of traditional psychoanalysis and decided to implement his own treatment program based on reality therapy. And something else very interesting about Glasser is that he does not believe in mental illness. However, he worked with, mental health patients. He actually had two theories. The first was developed in the 1960s based on identity theory, which is not covered in the text, but I'm actually going to give you a little bit of bonus insight about it at the end of this. And then the second, which is based on choice theory, and that's kind of what we're going to go over because that's what is in the Zastro text. One of the most important concepts that you can get out of all of this is that Glasser believes that everyone has a choice. Very, very important as we move forward. Glasser believed, again, everybody had a choice, has a choice. Choice theory, let's start with that. We carry around pictures in our heads of what our reality is like and how we would like it to be or what we might wish it to be. So we're carrying around these images in our head. And all of our behavior is an attempt to reduce the difference between the two. So reduce the fact of what is actually going on in your life versus the picture in your head. And if they are the same, then our needs have been met. If our picture in our head is different than our reality in real life, then we may attempt to close the gap by trying to work towards that wish. So you might think to yourself, what is your picture of your ideal mate compared to what you may have in your life? Your search for a mate is an attempt to decrease the difference between the wish and the reality. It's like we carry around a photo album in our heads of our ideals. So this might be created before or at birth, and we spend our life rearranging or adding to that photo album. So when we fulfill a need, we add a picture to our album and we can kind of flip the page. Our pictures might, have sight, sound, touch, smell, taste to them. Whatever image or, picture that we have in our heads may have our senses with it too. Are our pictures rational? Not necessarily. Let's think about, so we gave an example of what our ideal mate would be like. Women and sometimes men too may struggle. Well, what is our picture of our ideal body type? I know a lot of people shame themselves because they don't have this image in their head, or they have this image in their head and their reality is they look nothing like that. So this can create a lot of issues for people too. So what is the picture of an ideal body type for a person who might be anorexic or bulimic? How does that person attempt to reduce the difference between that? They're actually physically acting out on it. And can that person replace the wish rather than their reality? It's very difficult and very challenging, especially because, I believe it's body dysmorphic disorder. I may have the words backwards, but that is when you see this image of yourself and it's never going to be what you think it's going to be. So this image in our choice theory, this picture in our photo album is never going to be your reality because it's constantly changing. Even though you may have lost the weight, you're never going to see yourself as content with that image. So that may be an issue too. Can you change the picture? It's either going to be your wish or your reality. One of the two is going to change. We can do effective things to close the gap, such as maybe healthy eating, exercising, different things like that. But sometimes we may manipulate or do bad things for us, as in the example of anorexic or bulimic. And you could use this example with other pictures as well, too, but just to kind of give you a little bit of an example of how this works. So Glasser also has five basic needs in his choice theory as well. The first is to survive. Physical survival, hunger, warmth, thirst, sex, any of those basic needs, that is survival in his five basic needs. The second is to love and belong. So your family, your friends, pets, possessions, whatever makes you feel loved and belonged into your life. Power is the third one. Get others to obey us or do what we want, and the self-esteem and recognition that accompany that power. So our love and belonging and power can be at odds. You know, a couple may vie for power rather than cooperate and enhance that belonging. We also have freedom for number four, freedom to choose how they live, choose, you know, who you hang around with or where you're going to live or what you're going to do with your life. And then the last one is fun. So this can be socializing, recreational, sports, learning, working, any of those things could be the fun basic need. So those are Glasser's five basic needs. And remember, his fundamental principle is that we choose everything that we do. We are not victims of mental illness or others. Or if we have been taught that we are, we don't need to continue thinking that way. So people are in control of what they do. They do not, you know, they are not at the mercy of the stimuli. Insight will not produce change, and acting responsible will. There are some axioms of this choice theory. So I'm going to read through those. There's quite a few of them. I think there's 11 of them. So the first one is, the only person whose behavior we can control is our own. Very important rule of thumb. I feel like that applies to every therapy. No one can make us do anything we don't want to do. They can punish or reward us, but we can resist or perform poorly so as to not comply. Also, too, I think of this in a different perspective, maybe than Glasser, but I think of we can't control other people's behavior. We can only control our own. So keeping that in mind when people tend to blame or shift it onto other people. There's an exercise on page 459 to 460 for you to describe a time that you tried to change someone else's behavior or someone you were dating, for example. How did you try to change them? Were you successful? If so, did they change willingly or through coercion? And describe a time that someone else tried to change your behavior, such as a parent, maybe, or probation officer, whoever. And, you know, you're asking the same follow-up questions as above. So it's definitely something to kind of think about or keep in mind as you work through this. The second axiom of choice theory is all we can give or get from other people is information. How we deal with that information is our choice. So there may be consequences to how we deal with that information. The third is all we can do from birth to death is to behave. Behavior is acting, thinking, feeling in your physiology. So we are constantly behaving throughout our life. Four, all long-lasting psychological problems are relationship problems, which in turn cause other problems, including physical ones. So our usual way of dealing with what an unimportant relationship that has not worked out the way we want it to is to choose misery, whether it be emotional misery or physical misery. Relationships, we kind of always kind of go jump back to this about how important they are in the work with our clients. Number five, human brains are very creative. They can shield us from pain. We can create crazy scenarios in our heads. So our brains are very creative, whether it be for good or bad. Number six, unsatisfying relationships are the primary sources of crime, addiction, and emotional and behavioral disorders. So again, falling back on that relationship thing, you know, a person can make or break us sometimes if we let that happen. We are constantly worried about how others view us or see us. Number seven, we cannot control others very well by nagging, preaching, punishing, or threatening other people. So that's going to backfire on us if we continue with those types of behaviors. There's an exercise on page 461 to 462 that kind of talks a little bit about this, and you could take a look at that on your own. Number eight, the problem relationship is always a current one. We cannot live happily without at least one satisfying relationship in our lives. So if we don't have one positive relationship in our life, it's going to be really hard to kind of move forward. Remember, our relationship could be with our pet, our person, whatever, whoever we need to have it with, we need a positive relationship. Number nine, the solving circle is a good strategy to improve your relationships. You can read more about that on page 462. Number 10, painful events in the past have a lot to do with who we are today, but dwelling on them contributes little to improving current important relationships. So although they may make a part of our life, they're not the sole focus of our life. We have to be able to move on from it at some point. You have to deal with it and move on. Number 11, we don't need to know the past before we deal with the present. Sometimes in therapy, that is kind of an angle that some therapists may go on, is that they want to dissect your entire past. And then, you know, you're like, okay, well, what does this have to do with right now? So I have found that if you start with right now with a person and you deal with that, then some of the past stuff may come up, and it doesn't necessarily have to deal with, you know, solving the current situation. So I think that that's an interesting point of this choice theory. On page 463 to 464, they talk about letting go of grudges. You know, grudges could really be harmful for us. So what this therapy does is it encourages responsible behavior and learning better ways of functioning. What does a therapist do with choice theory? Confronts the clients with their excuses, encourage them to take responsibility for their thoughts and behaviors. So a little bit more challenging and confronting, combative maybe at times, than our solution-focused work, but you're getting them to kind of, you know, accept and move on from it. Reject excuses from your clients. Our therapists are encouraging responsible behavior. Call behavior responsible or irresponsible and help people agree when their behavior is irresponsible and value judgments on it. Praise responsible behaviors. Foster involved relationships. Again, importance of relationships. Focus on behavior, not feelings. You can change your feelings by changing your behavior. You might be contracting with your person. Natural consequences, not punishment for your clients. A therapist is no or little sympathy for them. They rarely ask the why question. People will come up with reasons to maintain irresponsible behavior if you're asking why. And lastly, therapists don't rely on clients' case histories because they rarely reveal the client's strengths and successes, which are more important than their trauma, weaknesses, or failures. So again, that last little bit of the axioms of choice is that you're not relying on the past. The past doesn't have to define the success or the solution. And lastly, in this choice theory is evaluation. The effectiveness of the older version has been studied and validated, which is the identity theory, which we're going to go over in a moment. And it has been applied in a variety of settings, such as juvenile corrections, mental health, education, and welfare. There's been little research on this newer version of this choice theory. There are some things that it doesn't explain, such as why some people with identical backgrounds do one thing and some do another, or why some may rob, others murder, and others abuse their children, but other helping strategies may not do either. All right, so let's talk for a moment about identity theory. So, and this is not in your text, so we're not going to have any quizzes on this or anything, but I just wanted to provide as much information as I could for you. So identity theory, you know, we all have the need for an identity and that we are different from everyone else on Earth. We are unique. The identity of two types. There's a success identity and a failure identity. So our success identity is through love and worth, and our failure identity is not enough love and not enough worth. And, you know, so distortion of reality to feel more significant is what causes mental illness. And mental illness in identity theory is chosen. People are aware of real world, but they choose to ignore reality. They believe it to be a myth. The better word for it is irresponsible, but with excellent potential to improve. If we treat them as same, they will do so too. Labels have a negative effect. Mental illness is real in exactly the same sense in which witches were real. That was from Thomas Szasz. I'm definitely all about agreeing that labels are negative. I don't feel that a person should be defined or live by their label. Labels go to those people for whom family and community don't accept their behavior, or the professional believes in the medical model and the value of diagnosis. Because yes, a person has to have a diagnosis. Unfortunately, we need a way to bill and we need a way to kind of classify what symptoms a person may be having, but that doesn't mean that a person has to live by it. So if a person has bipolar disorder, it doesn't mean that they are just a bipolar person. And I think it's unfair to, you know, use that label towards a person, because it is constantly going to be other persons like scapegoat that, oh, well, they're just bipolar and that's why they act the way that they do. And then the person eventually is going to feel their self-esteem is going to keep going down and down and down because they're constantly being reinforced by this label. Well, I'm bipolar, so I can't do better. Oh, I could go off on such tangents about labeling, but I'll save you from that. So, you know, people can live up to their labels, and that could be a bad thing. You know, what do reality therapists use as labels or terms? It might be depression, anxiety, excessive fear, feelings of failure, etc. These are personal problems and they're not illnesses. So what we want now is more important than what happened in the past, and dwelling on the past is a waste of time. So if it is discussed, it is always related to whatever their current behavior is. If their past is brought up, we relate it to now. And it says that success and failure types associate more with each other, so opposites don't attract. Just a little bit about identity theory. Again, there's more information out there if that's something that you want to look more into. But I just wanted to give you a little rundown of it. All right, thanks for watching. We will keep moving forward.